move on to the second topic here. The topic is GI motility, what's all the pressure about, by Dr.Preethi. I take pleasure in introducing Dr.Preethi here. Dr.Preethi has come? Yes. Dr.Preethi is an MBBS from Keppegowda Institute of Medical College, Bangalore. And then she worked as resident medical officer in Ramakrishna Hospital, Bangalore, senior house officer, Department of Medicine, Southern Railways, Chennai. Then she did her DNB in general medicine, 2006 to 2009, Southern Railways headquarters hospital, Chennai. 2009 to 2010, she worked as registrar of the Department of Gastroenterology at Apollo Hospitals. 2010 to 2013, she did her DM Gastroenterology Stanley Medical College. Passed her DM in 2013 and also qualified for MRCP. She worked as a senior registrar and a junior consultant in the Department of Gastroenterology. Presently working as independent consultant in the Department of Medical Gastroenterology, Apollo Hospital. Rich experience. Areas of interest, diagnostic and therapeutic endoscopy, GI physiology, endoscopic ultrasound, GI physiology and motility. We have a right speaker here. Over to you, Dr.Preethi. Yes.
Good afternoon. Thank you, sir, for the kind introduction. Today's topic is GI motility, and the reason why I chose this topic is because gastroenterology has always been associated with endoscopy, colonoscopy, and perhaps ERCP. It's always seen more as a therapeutic or an invasive specialty. This is one of the new emerging aspects of gastroenterology, which has to do more with GI physiology. Perhaps often ignored or given second preference by even my own colleagues. But we have found that there is so much of information to be gathered using manometry as a diagnostic tool. And since it is invasive but minimally so, it is much safer than so many other procedures for us to make valuable inferences. I just thought that I would give a brief overview regarding the basics of GI manometry. Basically two parts. Esophageal and anorectal. These are the two areas where manometry is presently being used. What I would be talking about is the principle of esophageal and anorectal manometry, its uses, its indications, the basic procedure, and some interesting cases. What one needs to know is that the manometry system is basically a system that measures the amplitude and the type of peristalsis either across the esophagus or in the anorectum. It is basically a very low maintenance unit. All we need is sterile water and a 16-channel catheter which is inserted through the patient's nose, transnasal insertion like a Raoul's tube, placed at strategic points which are indicative of the esophageal sphincter. And when we ask a patient to swallow water, it is seen as a pressure wave in our computer system. So the assimilation is pretty easy, and once we learn to see how a normal wave looks like when there is a normal peristalsis across the esophagus, abnormal findings can then be assessed well. This is how the catheter looks. It is about 4 millimeters thick, something like a 16 French Ryle's tube, and pretty much feels like a Ryle's tube. And it is then connected, if you can see, there is a black capillary system. The catheter is connected to that, and once the patient has the catheter in situ through the nose into the food pipe or the esophagus across the lower esophageal sphincter, water perfuses through these capillaries into the catheter, and this is then assimilated by a computer software specially designed for this. Next. So coming to esophageal manometry, why is this so important? Because now we find that peristaltic disorders of the esophagus are much more common than we did think, and prior, while we did have the barium swallow and even scintigraphic studies, this is as good or even now is considered the gold standard for diagnosis of motility disorders. Next. This is what happens when a person normally swallows. First, the swallow reaches the posterior pharynx, then the upper esophageal sphincter relaxes. Then the food bolus is propelled through the esophagus by a peristalsis, reaches the lower esophageal sphincter, which opens, and therefore this is the completion of a swallow. So what we get next, what we generally see in an esophageal manometry is a peristaltic swallow. When a patient swallows water, what we give to the patient is generally 5 ml of normal water. But before you do an esophageal manometry, it is very important to obtain a good patient history. What are you looking for in a patient when they have been referred to you for a manometry? It is mandatory that a patient has undergone an upper GI endoscopy prior to this, because mechanical disorders of the esophagus should be ruled out. Mechanical obstruction must be ruled out before we do a manometry, because you can have false abnormal reports. And if there is a suspicion of achalasia cardiae in a patient, we generally advise them to come with an overnight fast to avoid regurgitation of food and discomfort to the patient. Next. Now this is what is called the ideal esophageal peristalsis. It is like a sine curve. If you see above, that corresponds to the upper esophageal sphincter, which opens. This is the pressure wave. This is the lower esophageal sphincter, which is relaxed. Therefore, this is a normal swallow. Next. So when we talk of dysmotility, it can either be that pressures are too high or too low. Both cases, patient is symptomatic. Patient can feel either chest pain due to high pressures or a feeling of hold up or always a foreign body sensation when the pressures are inadequate. Next. So they either hypermotile or hypomotile disorders. Hypermotile, the commonest that we see in our practice is achalasia cardiae, which is characterized by an absent or inappropriate relaxation of the lower esophageal sphincter. Other hyperperistaltic disorders that now we are seeing with increasing frequency, especially through our referral population, is this hypertensive or nutcracker esophagus or a jackhammer esophagus, and less commonly a distal esophageal spasm. All of these which are characteristically seen on manometry. Next. These are less common but causes of decreased peristalsis, where mainly patient can present to you either with a feeling of hold up or a feeling of choking, history suggestive of GERD, mixed connective tissue diseases such as systemic sclerosis, SLE, etc. Such patients are commonly associated with hypomotility of the esophagus. And manometry is very useful, because if you can show that a patient has a decreased or ineffective peristalsis, you will augment these patients with prokinetics to enhance peristalsis. Next. This basically makes up our general population, I mean referral population. Mainly our most commonest indication we find is achalasia, followed by GERD. Then we also require this prior 24 hour pH monitoring. Patients who have been thoroughly investigated for non-cardiac chest pain, and pediatric children with suspected GERD or congenital infantile achalasia. Next. These are some case scenarios that I would like to show you. This was a 23-year-old female. She was branded as somatization disorder. She had undergone 6 endoscopies outside. and told to attend a psychiatric clinic. She was referred here by a physician with a suspicion of aphasia, though she did not have overt symptoms. Now, if you see this, the previous normal peristalsis was a sine curve, but here if you see, you can just see pink high pressure zones, and this remains a straight pink line without any opening or relaxation. This is characteristic of type 2 aphasia cardia. So when this patient had a detailed endoscopy, again, it was clearly seen that she had pooling in the esophagus with a resistance at the LES, and she did extremely well after a balloon dilatation. Next. This patient had episodic chest pain, had a thorough cardiac investigation, everything found to be normal, including a coronary angiogram, but he continued to be symptomatic. Now, if you were to see, this looks very abnormal. It is very black rather than pink. Black indicating the highest pressure amplitudes. This is characteristic of what is called a jackhammer esophagus. And these patients do well with calcium channel blockers. Rarely, this can be associated with severe GERD, with spasm due to reflux. In such case, a combination of PPIs with calcium channel blockers gives very good symptom relief. Next. Again, this was a patient with long-standing dysphagia, and if you see, this is somewhat similar to the first one, except that there is a higher pressure component here, but the lower esophageal sphincter remains a rigid line. This is characteristic of a type 3 aphasia. These patients generally do well with a myotomy rather than a balloon dilatation. Next. This is a 27-year-old lady diagnosed mixed connective tissue disorder, always with the foreign body sensation and bolus impactions in the past. If you see, there is nothing here. It is blank. There is no peristalsis. So this is associated with an absent or ineffective esophageal motility. Such patients have to be advised head and elevation. They need prokinetics along with proton pump inhibitors to alleviate symptoms. Next. Now this is an obese male with troublesome GERD symptoms. And if you see, he has a very, very light, low amplitude peristaltic curve, which is not like the normal pink curve that we saw. This again means this is a fragmented or ineffective peristalsis. Such patients have to be advised lifestyle modifications, predominantly weight reduction, as well as PPIs and other modifications. So this was in brief about esophageal manometry. Now from cranial coming to caudal, since we deal with both extremes, now, what are the things we see on anorectal manometry? If you see, the main thing that we assess is the sphincter, the anal sphincter, which is composed of next two parts, the internal and the external. The internal, not in our control, the external, which is skeletal, which is predominantly under our voluntary control. And the puborectalic sling, which is very important to aid continence. Next. Very similar to the catheter, very similar in dimensions, except that you will see there is a white balloon attached to the end of the catheter, and of course this goes in through the anal sphincter. This balloon is paramount for the final or the gold standard test to assess if a patient has fecal dyssynergy, which is the balloon expulsion test. Next. Again, it also has 16 canals, very similar, and if you see, we can see these following characteristics. Basal pressures, which are should be in the range of 40 to 80. So if a patient comes to you with history of incontinence, you have a lax sphincter, if pressures are 25, you can say that the patient has a weak or a hypotensive anal sphincter. Squeeze, which is mainly indicative of the external sphincter function or voluntary sphincter function, can be reduced in patients who had surgeries on the anal sphincter, post-delivery, diabetes, and CVAs, etc. We also measure the strain, which is an indication of the rectal pressures, and very important in children, the rectoanal inhibitory reflex. This test is very, very useful in children with suspected Hirschsprung's disease, where if you elicit an RAIR, it's almost always rules out the Hirschsprung disease. It obviates the need for a full thickness rectal biopsy for the same. And if a patient is able to expel a 50cc air-filled balloon, it indicates that they have a coordinated sense of defecation. There is no dyssynergy in the patient. Next. So again, these are our referral population patients, mainly for the evaluation of constipation. If a patient has dyssynergic defecation, that is, patient says, I spent 30 minutes in the toilet, the more I strain, the less stool comes out. I have to apply pressure on my bottom to facilitate defecation. I have to use my finger to evacuate the stool. This is very, very common. Patients don't come out with this history until we ask for it. Pediatric refluxes, mainly habitual constipation, and to rule out the presence, to rule in the presence of a rectoanal inhibitory reflux. And we also offer what is called a biofeedback for patients who have fecal incontinence and dyssynthetic defecation. Next. So these are the evacuation disorders that we see. Please look for these symptoms in patients when they come to you. And these patients might well merit a referral for a manometry to look for evidences of abnormal defecatory disorders. Next. Now, if you see, this is an example of a dyssynergic defecation. If you look at this vertical line, it implies the rectal pressure. This is when a patient has been asked to strain. We usually do the test in a supine position. Of course, this is not the natural way that a person defecates. Unfortunately, our software is yet not developed to aid testing in sitting position. So all the simulated tests are done in lateral, left lateral, but supine position. So when a patient has been asked to strain, if you see this horizontal line, that implies it is the anal sphincter. And here the patient is doing a very good job of straining. You can see a very good line here. But this black implies that the anal sphincter is much tighter than the rectum. So the patient is straining, but the anal sphincter is closing even more. These are the patients who come to you saying that the more I strain, the less stool comes out and I'm not able to evacuate. So this is classical of dyssynergy. Incontinence, yes, this we see more often in women than in men. For one thing, physiologically, the female sphincter does not have the same pressures as does the male sphincter. Very commonly seen after delivery, forceps, ventouse, perineal tears, patients do not come out with this unless you probe. They most time often also have urinary incontinence or stress incontinence. So please spend time with the patient before we come to conclusions that it is truly a problem and not just patient's worry or irritable problem. And this causes a huge impact on quality of life. Such people walk around with diapers. They are very scared to go out to functions. So it has a huge negative impact on quality of life. Now if you see the previous thing, it was black. Here if you see, there is really not much of a line at all. It's yellow and some pink. Here we actually ask the patient to squeeze tight the way she or he would do if they want to prevent defecation. But this is all the patient is able to do. And if you see one more line here, the patient is actually tightening her gluteal to aid in closure of the anal sphincter. So this is very characteristic of an external anal dysfunction where patient will present to you with urge incontinence most often. Next. And the advantages of anorectal manometry is no preparation is required. Some centers ask for an enema. We generally don't ask for anything because more or less the rectum.
Physician's prayer. Dear Lord, O great physician, I kneel before thee. Since every good and perfect gift must come from thee, I pray, give skill to my hands, clear vision to my mind, kindness and sympathy to my heart. Give singleness of purpose, strength to lift at least a part of the burden of my suffering fellow man, and a true realization of the privilege that is mine. Take from my heart all quiet and worldliness that with the simple faith of a child I rely on thee. Indian Medical Association prayer. May everybody be happy. May every one of us see to it that nobody suffers from any pain or sorrow. I do not ask for crown, nor I wish to be in heaven or reborn. I only want to elevate the suffering of those people who are burning in fire of sorrow. Thank you. Please take your seats.
Before we start our regular CME, I request Dr. Mani, our past president, to hand over the FSS check to the family members of late Dr. B.J. Patsarvi.
May I request Mrs. Patsarvi, his family members, to come. Mitra Patsarvi is a regular presenter of cases. Dr. Pasta, the vice president, this FSS check has come. In fact, I was touched when Mrs. Parsadi told me that he has enlisted 6 members as emergency, if you please contact them. And my number was one of them. I was really touched by the gesture of Dr. Parsad. I request Dr. Chandrasekhar to come and Dr. Edelson.
Now we go on to our regular monthly CME meetings. The first topic is National Medical Council Bill on Mother Punjab by Dr. Edelson and Dr.Preethi.
Please, those who are willing to join the concessional rate of IMA membership, please rush your application form before midnight or early morning to my office. We will send the last dispatch of papers tomorrow at 10 a.m. After that, the membership will be ready. Second thing, the FSS has started a new scheme, FSS 2. I request all of you please join that also, because from June, people above 50 years cannot join this scheme. The youngsters are, been objecting that elders pay less amount and get more money. That's not point of discussion at this meeting at all. But it's a beneficiary scheme for the family. I request all of you motivate yourself and motivate your friends to join the FSS 2 scheme. Who are not members of FSS 1, I request all of you please join. I hand over my question.
Thank you, sir. Now I request Dr.Preethi to talk very shortly about the NMC Medical Council Bill and Mother Punjab.
Miami. At the outset, I thank the President and Secretary of the Kodambakam AMA and also Professor Chandrasekhar has given me the opportunity to share my views about the National Medical Council Bill. We are all here, the communicated here, gathered here to gain the medical knowledge. Why we want to gain the medical knowledge? There are two things important. One, indirectly we can give good treatment to the society. We give good treatment to the people. And also, we can gain the medical knowledge to update our knowledge system. In other words, to feel ourselves very proud about that I am also being updated on the medical curriculum. So that is the reason why we have gathered here, to gain our medical acumen. But at the same time, if something has happened for the medical fraternity, some abnormal thing has happened for the people of our Tamil Nadu or in India, we should also organize, we should almost echo our views about anything which impediment to our medical system and also the people of Tamil Nadu. In that's the way, I want to share my views about the National Medical Council Bill. There is the NMC Bill, National Medical Council Bill, basically it is an anti-democratic bill, anti-federalistic bill, it is an anti-socialistic bill, it is an anti-poor, anti-medical bill. The basically NMC Bill is comprised of all those things. Because when we go to read the bill per se, if you don't get a BP, you will get a BP. If you go to a diabetes, you will get a diabetes after reading the bill, entire the bill. It contains more than 200 pages. Before I talk about the NMC Bill, I will give the brief history of National Medical Council Bill and the framework. In the Lok Sabha, 29th December of 2017, this bill was placed. At this juncture, our IMA members, associations, IMA associations, and Tamil Nadu Medical Council Board, and the representatives from the state government, and the legalist, socialist, all the doyens of the medical fraternity will oppose the National Medical Council Bill. That is the reason government has not passed the bill in the floor, on the floor. They have passed it to the standing committee. So this is the issue.